Okay, so it's a pleasure for me to introduce the second speaker this afternoon. And he is Jong Hae-kyun from the Korea Institute for Advanced Study. And he's going to talk on algebraic surfaces with minimal Betti numbers.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation. It's my great pleasure and honor to speak here at ICM 2018. I will talk about more concrete classification problem, classification of algebraic surfaces with minimum possible invariant, especially Betti numbers. Here's the outline of my talk. Q-homology projective planes and Montgomery-Young problem. This is actually a differential topology problem, but this is one of the a source of motivation why we study this. Not only these surfaces subject of interest in from algebraic geometry point of view, but also it related to kind of differential topology, a circle action on five-dimensional sphere, and it's algebraic version. And finally, I will speak on quite fascinating progress on fake projective planes. Okay, well, this page, maybe you have seen this many talks at this ICM, maybe Donaldson and Birkar, and even Sonyang Ellis Chang's talk. Well, algebraic geometers, the main goal is classify algebraic varieties up to connected moduli. We will walk over the field C of complex numbers. Well, in dimension one, algebraic varieties of dimension one are called algebraic curves. And smooth algebraic curves over complex number field, nothing but Riemann surfaces, are classified by the mighty genus. Genus is defined to be the number of holes of C. So mathematically, it is a dimension, complex dimension of the space of differential one form, global differential one forms on C. And this is half of the first Betti number. This Q vector, this is a Q vector space. And furthermore, for algebraic curves, genus equal zero characterize the curve as P1 or Riemann sphere. In dimension two, as you see, we have more different types of holes, so more invariants. So we have several invariants. Classically, this is called the geometric genus, PG, and this is the dimension of second cohomology of structure shape. And irregularity is the dimension of first cohomology space of structure shape. When X is smooth, this is equal to this. This is a space of global two forms on X, and this is global one forms on X. And also we have, as a topological space, we have Betti numbers. Well, even if X is not smooth, we still have this definition. And you may think of minimal resolution of X, and then you can think of its PG. So in general, PG of minimal resolution and PG of original surface may not equal. But if the singularities are very mild, for example, rational singularities, then these two are equal. Well, smooth algebraic surfaces with PG equal Q equal zero, well, this class of surfaces studied for a long time, for example, Castellanova's rationality criterion and Severi conjecture. Well, Castellanova's rationality criterion says that Q equal zero and second plurigenus equal zero characterizes rational surfaces. And then Severi made several conjectures saying that the PG equal to equal zero and plus some other condition might characterize rationality. But unfortunately, most of his conjectures turned out to be false. But anyway, this is a kind of a driving force. By Enrique Godaira classification of algebraic surfaces, which was done in the middle of 20th century, in fact, algebraic case, Enrique classification is already enough, but complex surfaces, Godaira classification, finishes the program. And these surfaces are one of these, P2, or rational ruled surfaces, Enrique surfaces, properly elliptic surfaces with PG equal to P equal to zero, and surfaces of general type with PG equal to zero, and these surfaces further classified by this number, K square is equal to 1 through 9. And of course, a blow up of above surfaces, so these are minimal surfaces. For example, K3 surface doesn't belong to this class, but because it has PG equal 1, and the ruled surface over a curve with positive genus doesn't belong to here because it has positive irregularity, and so on. And smooth algebraic surfaces with minimal invariant, that is PG equal 3 equal 0, first, third Betti number equal 0, and first, second, fourth Betti number equal 0. Well, this condition is kind of automatic because we always talking about connected variety, irreducible variety. So the essential condition is second Betti number is equal to 1. And first Betti number is equal to 0 implies irregularity 0. And second Betti number is equal to 1 implies PG equal 0. So this front condition is not necessary. But anyway, in this case, we have P2 and fake project planes. These are surfaces of general type with PG equal 0 and K square equal to 9. So we'll go back to this one later. Here, let me remark that exotic P2, these are kind of holy grail among differential topologies for manifold people. These are simply connected for manifold, which is homeomorphic to CP2, but not diffeomorphic to CP2. But this one does not exist in complex geometry. Okay, here's the definition of Q-homology P2. A normal projective surface is called a Q-homology P2 if it has the same Betti number as P2. In other words, here. If S is smooth, then we have P2 or fake projective plane. And if S has very small singularities, like A1 singularity or A2 singularity, then this is rather easy exercise. You can actually check that these are all possibilities. So this is a quadratic cone, and this is a quotient of P2 by a group of order 3 or order 9, or fake project plane marked out by a group of order 3 or order 9. Here, order 9 with 3 elementary. Or mixed case, this one has one A1 singularity and one A2 singularity. So in this talk, S has at worst quotient singularities. Then S is a Q-homology P2 if second Betti number is equal to 1. So this condition already is strong enough to enforce the first Betti number equal to 0, because if first Betti number is positive, then the minimal resolution, you think of minimal resolution, then the Albanese map will give you a certain vibration, and then all exceptional curves will belong to the union of similar fibers. And then in this way, you can see that actually the second Betti number is at least two. So for a minimal resolution, in this case, then for any rational singularities, the minimal resolution also has vanishing geometric genus and irregularity. So here are some examples. So here we have second Betti number is equal to one. So we have Picard number is equal to one. So canonical class, here of course we are talking about canonical class of singular surface. So this canonical class is Weyl divisor, not necessarily Kaité divisor. You can think of differential metamorphic forms on smooth parts, and then you can think of zeros and poles, and then you take the closure. So this will give you a Weyl divisor. But anyway, so we have here, in this case, negative ample means Ks intersection with any curve on the surface is negative. And here, numerically trivial means Ks intersection with any curve is zero. And ample means Ks intersection with any curve is positive. Well, in this case, minus Ks is ample, or Ks is numerically trivial. We have plenty of examples, just to show you. But Ks is ample, then kind of we are lack of examples. So the problem is difficult because we don't have enough examples in some sense. So these are, for example, quotient effect project planes, suitable contraction of a suitable blow-up of some NDK surfaces, and also suitable contraction of suitable blow-up of some rational surface, even T2. So the minimal resolution could take all possible Godaira number here. But the first question is how many singular points on S with quotient singularities? Here, the orbifold BMY inequality, you can prove that easily the number of singular points is bounded by 5. Well, this is inequality of this form. The usual Bohr-Molopi-Miyaoka-Yau inequality is Ks squared, one-third of Ks squared is bounded by Euler number, second Chern class. But in this case, we have orbifold Euler number, which is usual Euler number. In this case, this is 3, but subtracted by contribution given by singularities. Here, this is local fundamental group at each singularity. And many examples with four singularities. And if Ks is negative ample, then it's still bounded by 4. With Dongson Huang and myself, we characterize the case with 5 singular points. So let S be a cohomology P2 with quotient singularities, then the number of singular points is bounded by 4, except the following case. S has 5 singular points of type 3A1 plus 2A3, and its minimal resolution is an NDK surface. Yeah, all rational double points. 3 rational double points of type A1, 2 rational double points of type A3. So this is a corollary. Every G homology P2 with quotient singularities has at most 4 singular points. Here, G homology means integral homology groups must be equal to the integral homology group of P2. And because here, the 5 singular point case come from NDK surface. NDK surface has a non-trivial torsion. First homology group is non-zero. So still, if you contract 9 curves on the surface into rational double points, you still get kind of same first homology group. So the resulting surface has non-trivial homology, first homology group. So it cannot be G homology P2. So every G homology, Z homology P2 with quotient singularities has at most 1 singular point. If it has, then the singularity must be of type EA. Well, it's a second remark. Why we restrict on quotient singularities only? If you allow homology P2 to have rational similarities, then you cannot bound the number of singular points. Actually, you can construct easily an example of Q homology P2 with arbitrarily many rational similarities. Here, Mongbari-Young problem, a smooth circle action on M-dimensional sphere. Okay, circle acts on SM differentiably, so circle group is a subgroup of diffeomorphism group of SM. The identity element of the circle acts identically on SM. Each diffeomorphism is homotopic or diffeotopic to the identity map. So by a Lefschetz fixed point formula, the Euler number of fixed locus of G is equal to Euler number of fixed locus of identity morphism. So this is nothing but Euler number of the space, sphere, M-dimensional sphere. If M is even, then this number is equal to 2. So any such action has a fixed point, so that the foliation by circles degenerate. So we assume M is odd. In this case, this is equal to 0. So in this case, we have this definition. A differentiable C-infinity action of S1 on S2n minus 1 is called a pseudo-free S1 action, circle action on S2n minus 1, if it is free except for finitely many orbits whose isotropy groups, the cyclic group of order AI, A1 through AK, all these groups have pairwise prime orders. Well, here, finitely many orbits, these orbits will be called exceptional orbits. So on this orbit, so circle action, so pick up one point, and then circle action will give you an orbit. In general, this is a circle. And exceptional orbit is nothing but the circle rotates this orbit many times. So each point will have a finite cyclic group, isotropy group. And if you think of the orbit fold, then this exceptional orbit will give you a singularity, kind of a cyclic singularity. Well, this is the standard example, linear actions. If you embed this odd dimensional sphere inside CN in this standard way, and also you embed this circle group standard way inside a complex line here, and then the action is given by this. Here, A1 through AN is kind of pairwise prime. Any integer, positive integer, non-negative integer. So in this linear case, the orbit fold is naturally isomorphic to N minus one dimensional weighted projective space with weight A1 through AN. And the orbit of the ith coordinate point is an exceptional orbit if and only if AI is at least 2. And the orbit of a non-coordinate point is not exceptional. So we have at most n exceptional orbits in this case. So this action has at most n exceptional orbits. And the quotient map is a Seifert fibration. So at each point you have a circle. So each fiber is a circle. Circle fibration over complex space. Well, n is equal to 2. Seifert showed that each pseudo-free circle action is linear and hence has at most two exceptional orbits. N is equal to 4, but in contrast, Montgomery-Young showed that given arbitrary collection of pairwise prime positive integers, there is a pseudo-free circle action on a homology S7 whose exceptional orbits have exactly those orders. And for n bigger than or equal to 5, a similar thing happens. So in higher dimension, namely n is bigger than or equal to 4, then you cannot bound this number of exceptional orbits. But in small dimension, n equal to 2, then it's 2. So here, then what happens when n is equal to 3 or S1 circle action on S5? Here's a conjecture. It's called Montgomery-Young problem raised by Pintusen and Stahn. A pseudo-free circle action on S5 has at most 3 exceptional orbits. So they think that this case more likely close to n is equal to 2 case. Well, this problem is still wide open. Actually, their paper contains a proof of O2 actions. O2 is the degree 2 extension of circle group. So under this condition, they prove this, but their proof is not, their proof has a gap. So, you know, in topology, usually in dimension high, then you have somehow some topological freedom. But this contrasting difference in algebraic geometry, if you go, the dimension goes up, then things get much more complicated, sometimes exponentially complicated. So here, pseudo-free circle action on a manifold sigma have been studied in terms of orbit space. So exceptional orbit gives a singular point whose neighborhood looks like a cone over a link. So here, the orbit space of such an action is a four-manifold with isolated singularities whose neighborhoods are cones over length spaces. So length spaces kind of quotient of S3 by a free action of cyclic group. Or link, remember, kind of link is the punctured cone corresponding to exceptional orbits of the S1 action. Well, I don't want to go into too much on this. This is too much topology. So the following S1, the following one-to-one correspondence was known to Montgomery-Young, Pintusen-Stahn, and revisited by Kohler. And there is one-to-one correspondence between pseudo-free circle action on Q-homology five-dimensional sphere with first homology trivial, integral homology trivial, and compact differentiable four-manifold with boundary such that each boundary is a length space, and the order of cyclic groups are pairwise prime, and first homology trivial, and second homology is infinite cyclic. And furthermore, if sigma is deep homology to S5, depend on if M is simply connected. So from this, Janosch Kohler formulated algebraic Montgomery-Young problem. This is Montgomery-Young problem when the orbit fold attains a structure of a normal projective surface. Here now, let's forget about circle action. We just concentrate on algebraic geometry problem. Let S be a Q-homology P2 with at worst quotient singularities. If the smooth part, you throw away singular points, is simply connected, then S has at most 3 singular points. So this is exactly, if this conjecture is true, then this solves affirmatively Montgomery-Young problem in the algebraic case. Well, I look at, what if the condition, this is homotopy condition, is replaced by the weaker condition, homology condition. There are infinitely many examples, S, with homology group is trivial, but fundamental group is non-trivial. But with four singular points. So these examples doesn't give you any counterexample to this conjecture, because it has four. But it is not simply connected. But these examples obtained from the classification of surfaces are surface quotient singularities given by Brisson. Here, Brisson classified quotient singularities, two-dimensional quotient surface singularities. Here this, a certain group IM, which is the extension of A5, the alternating group of degree 5, first, smallest non-abelian simple group. and extended by cyclic over 2m. And then this group acts on C2 and naturally extend to P2, and then you can think of the quotient in orbifold space. And this is a G-homology P2 with negative KS ample. And it has four quotient singularities, and it's a smooth part as fundamental group A5, hence homology group is trivial. While we have some progress on this problem, let's SVA Q homology P2 with quotient singularities, not all cyclic, such that a smooth part is simply connected, then so that the Collatz conjecture is true. More precisely, we have more than four, then it must be a Briskon quotient. So we proved even more precise in this case, and more progress. So in this case deals with homology, Q-homology P2 with cyclic singularities such that first homology group of smooth part is trivial. If either S is not rational or minus K is ample, then the conjecture holds. So what is the remaining case? That this is the remaining case of algebraic Montgomery-Young problem. Let S be a Q-homology P2 satisfying two conditions, as a cyclic singularities only, because non-cyclic we already done. And S is a rational surface with KS ample. This is a rational surface, but KS is ample. Well, smooth case, this one never happened, but this is a singular surface. So the first question is, are there such surfaces? If you look at the adjunction formula, this S prime is a minimal resolution of S. You see, this is S prime is a rational surface, so this is not quite positive, but this is positive. Means that this part, the contribution coming from singularities, must be bigger than the canonical class. So yes. Examples given by Sean Kill and James McConnell, and also Janusz Kolla. There's an infinite series of examples with number of singular points is 2. And then Dongsun Huang and myself construct another example, infinite series of examples with number of singular points 1 and 3. Of course, our method can also produce 2. Here's a problem. Are there any Q-homology P2, which is a rational surface S with KS ample and with four singular points? Here, I just drop cyclic singularities or even simply connectedness of smooth part. So here, these examples, how we construct these examples, if you start with P2, then you pick up Rhines and conics and cuspidal cubic or nodal cubic. All these are rational curves. So even singular is okay. You pick up certain union of rational curves whose degree must be bigger than 3. And keep in mind that after Schutoble level blow up, and the proper transform of all these curves should be contracted into certain singularities so that the resulting surface should have become number 1. So it's easy to say, but in practice, it's very difficult to construct such examples. But I think this is a general case. So we know rational surface very well, but somehow not quite. We still don't know much about P2. Okay, so here I don't have much to say. This is a symplectic Montgomery-Young problem. But this is the symplectic case. But here maybe this is a guiding problem. Can you establish Bogomolfi inequality for symplectic compact four manifolds? And we also have in positive characteristic, we have similar notion. In this case, we call QL cohomology here. LRD cohomology in characteristic P, where L is a prime, any prime different from from P. Then you can think of Betti numbers and Picard number here also. So we have some classification of special cases, some Gordenstein and canonical class, numerical trivial. Okay, so I have 15 minutes. Then let's go back to let's come to fake project planes. Fake project planes, as I said before, in algebraic case, but this even a compact complex surface with the same Betti numbers as P2 is called a fake project plane if it is not bi-holomorphic to P2. So here, the name fake comes from. So it looks like P2 because they're same Betti numbers, but it is not isomorphic to it. On a fake project plane, in brief FPP, has ample canonical divider class. So it is a smooth, proper, geometrically connected surface of general type with geometric genus 0 and k is k equal 9. Well, this definition doesn't depend on complex numbers. This definition is free of characteristic. The existence of a FPP was first proved by Mumford about 40 years ago, based on the theory of two-ed uniformization. This is a very abstract method, nothing concrete. And later, two more examples by Ishida Kato in this abstract method. And myself gave a construction of a FPP with an order 7 automorphism, which is birational to an order 7 cyclic cover of a Dolgachev surface, simply connected Godard dimension 1 elliptic surface. My surface and Mumford surface belong to the same class according to the Prasad Jung and Prasad and Jung, in the sense that their fundamental groups are both contained in the same maximal arithmetic subgroup of the isometric group of the complex unit two-ball. FPPs, fake project planes, have Chern numbers, here k square and 3 times Euler number. And these are complex two-ball quotient by the result of Obeng and Yao. And this was already mentioned in Donaldson's plenary lecture. Actually, Obeng proved the case, but Yao proved include one more case with canonical class is trivial. Such ball quotients are strongly rigid by most of the rigidity theorem. In other words, these are determined by a fundamental group up to holomorphic or anti-holomorphic isomorphism. Fake project planes come in complex conjugate pairs by Kharlamov and Kulikov. They show that the complex conjugate of a fake project plane is never isomorphic to original surface. They're always distinct. And they have been classified as quotient of two-dimensional complex ball by explicitly written co-compact torsion-free arithmetic subgroup of PU21 by Prasad and Jung and Cartwright and Steger. Actually, Prasad and Jung gave a kind of list of classes, commensurable classes, and then Cartwright and Steger carried out explicit computation. So all fundamental groups are given explicitly as a subgroup of 3x3 matrix group. Well, the arithmeticity plays key role here, but it was proved by Klingler. And after all, there are exactly 100 fake project planes total, and corresponding to 50 distinct fundamental groups. Well, the number is too good to believe, but the fake project planes are fascinating object. So the number is total number is also fascinating number. So. Well, still many interesting problems. Somehow this classification finished one side of classification, this arithmetic side of. But the geometric side, still we have many problems. For example, exceptional collections in the derived category, or bounded complexes, coherent sheaves on a fake projective plane X, and bicanonical map, and explicit equations, and block conjecture on zero cycles, and modular forms. Well, the last two topics, I don't know. That's a very interesting question. Block conjecture still need to be checked on these surfaces. And we don't know any single modular form on the two-dimensional complex board. Here, exceptional collection. Galkin, Kacharkov, Mellet, Sinder, they pose this conjecture. On every fake project plane, there is an exceptional sequence of length 3. This is maximum possible because the length cannot exceed Euler number, in this case 3. In other words, there is an ample line bundle L such that OX minus L minus 2L for an exceptional collection on X. Well, this is quite similar formulation for P2. So P2, OX, O minus 1, O minus 2, from an exceptional collection of maximal length. But for, as I said, fake project planes, all fake project planes have a non-trivial fundamental group. So if you think of a subcategory generated by these exceptional collections, could have semi-orthogonal complement. And this orthogonal complement is not zero, what they call a quasi-phantom. Well, this conjecture has been confirmed for several fake project planes by myself and these others and Fakhruddin. And also, for some fake project planes, such L is not unique. So two different L's could give you two different exceptional collections. So another topic is bicanonical map. For a fake project plane, X, the geometric genus is equal to zero, so there is no effective divisor which is linearly equivalent to canonical class. So there is no canonical map. So by applying Leydig's theorem, which is a result on adjoint linear systems to our fake project plane, then 2kx plus L is very ample for any ample line bundle L on X. For example, tricanonical map, you take L is equal to kx, then this is an embedding. But how about 2kx? Right? By Leydig's again, the bicanonical system is base point free. So defines a morphism. See, this is 27-dimensional space and this 9-dimensional space. So number of variables is much smaller. Is an embedding away from a finite number of points. And this finite number of points maps to a certain singular point onto the image surface. And this image is non-normal surface. And we show that with Catanese, the bicanonical map is a normalization map of the image. And furthermore, for the moment, for 10 pairs of fake project planes, this is about 20% of fake project planes, well, this bicanonical map is an embedding. Now, let me the final topic, equations of a fake project plane. Well, it has long been of great interest to, since Mumford to find equations of a project model of a fake project plane. Recently, with Lev Borisov, we found equations of a fake a project model. Indeed, the bicanonical image of a conjugate pair of fake project planes by studying the geometry of the quotient of such surface by an order 7 automorphism. Well, I have done some work on classification of all possible structures of quotient faculty plane. So this helped. And these equations are given explicitly as 84 cubics in 10 variables, I mean in P9, with coefficient in the field, quadratic extension, imaginary extension of rational number field. And the complex conjugate equations define the bicanonical image of the complex conjugate of the surface. All right, this pair of faithful project planes has the most geometric symmetries among the 50 pairs in the sense that it has the large automorphism group. This is the largest possible among all faithful project planes. And furthermore, the G7 quotient has a smooth model of 2-4 elliptic surface. This elliptic surface with two multiple fibers with multiplicity 2 and 4. So this elliptic surface is not simply connected. It has fundamental group of order 2. So you can think of universal curve of this elliptic surface, so which is not simply connected. So you can think of the universal curve. So the universal double curve of this elliptic surface has the Hodge numbers of a KC surface, PG equal 1, and H11 is equal to 20, and so on. But Godard dimension 1. And so in fact, we found a suitable divisor linear system on this surface, which gives a birational embedding into P3 as a hypersurface. So our search of these equations start from this. So, and then we found kind of go down and pushing and so on. Eventually we found 10 sections which gives the embedding of our fake property plane into P9. And then we found relations among these 10 sections. There are actually 84 relations. So here is the equations. Yeah, some of them is just kind of image of G3. G3 acts, here your UIs are coordinates, U0 through U9, and G3 is order 3 automorphism, fixing U0 and rotating 3 coordinates. And another automorphism, G7, is order 7 automorphism, which acts diagonally by a suitable power of 7 through top unity. Lev Borisov and myself, both former student of Igor Dolgachev at Ann Arbor, and he has been searching for the equations of fake projective plane for a long period of time. So we are very proud to present these equations to our former teacher. Okay. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thanks. So questions?
Yes.
Yes, exactly. We do have this. Well, actually, if you have these equations, you can double check using computer algebra like Macaulay 2 that these equations indeed define a projective plane. So you can have resolution. Well, this is you have here. Square root negative 7. So in using computer algebra, you should choose a suitable prime. So we compute over finite fields. So choose a suitably big prime, like a 200 something, and then find a certain number, which is a square root of negative 7, modulo this prime number. And then everything goes down to a finite field. And then you can, actually the computer algebra has program that give you resolution of this. And also you can compute Hilbert series so that you can compute K-square and also algebraic Euler characteristic. and so on. So when we search these equations, sometimes we just neglect some details, but eventually we double check so that our method was correct. So kind of we follow a physicist method. You know, physicists, they never worry about exact correctness. They just follow, eventually the nature will explain everything for them. So, but sometimes we mathematicians sometimes need a physicist attitude.
Okay, so yes?
It's more of a comment. You mentioned the Bloch conjecture on Zeeco cycles. Joseph Ayoub has announced a proof of the general Bloch conjecture for surfaces. Of course, it's a long, complicated argument, and it's still to be checked.
If it's correct. It's announced?
There's a preprint available.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But it's good to, very long and very complicated, and we don't know. I mean, people are trying to check. If it's right, then that would, in particular,
well, that would be wonderful, But that, I think the modular forms is a very interesting subject, but still we don't know anything about modular forms. Well, so this coordinate UI must correspond to certain modular form on the ball with respect to fundamental group.
Okay, so no more questions. Let's thank Jung Kim again.
Thank you.